WebAssembly. My name is Frederick. I'm on Twitter over there. And I work at a company called Time Edit. We're not international, but we want to be. But we're right over here in Gouda. We're about 20 people. And we're hiring. We're looking for C++ developers, coincidentally. Very interesting. And we're a product company. We make scheduling and resource management software, which for the most part right now means scheduling for universities. That's our big thing. We have all of them around here. And but we want to be much bigger. We want to do a lot with our C++ software. So if you're interested in joining a product company rather than a consulting company like this one, please come talk to us. Hi. job.timeedit.com. That's about it. And I work there as mostly as a front-end developer, but I've broken code in all parts of the system, including the C++ side. I can bad access with the best of them. And I also do some podcasts. And also, this is important. I'm not that much of a C++ developer, so why am I talking about this? Why am I talking about WebAssembly? In short, because it's one of those exciting things. It's happened, I'll explain a bit what it is and how it works, but it's one of those really in-between things. I work mostly in the front end, mostly in JavaScript, and I hear about WebAssembly and I think, this sounds really cool. It doesn't feel like it's quite for me, who could it be for? And then sort of thinking that this could be for C++ developers. Maybe. How does it work? How does it work from the C++ side? I want to sort of figure it out or get other people to figure it out and realize sort of what's out there. So it feels a little bit like exploring the future. Future tech, 115, civilization, first one. It's good. I feel like we're sort of living in the future. This is one of those areas we could do so many cool things if we sort of put our minds to it. So this is about trying to start thinking about it, trying to start to see what's out there and how it works, and maybe getting some new ideas. So, what is it? WebAssembly or WASM really rolls off the tongue. What is it? There's a definition. You can really feel the marketing money at work here. Binary instruction formats. That's basically the important part. It's a compilation target for code. And the point of it is to get other languages than JavaScript to run with great performance inside a web browser. Which is exciting, because so many people, people have opinions about JavaScript. It's become a nice language. It can do lots of stuff, it runs in lots of places. But there are other languages out there, people thinking other languages than JavaScript. There have also been other projects to compile languages to JavaScript, plenty of them. Google has something called NACL, there's ASM.js as well, and WebAssembly sort of inherits from those, borrows the ideas and tries to make a cleaner implementation for a bunch of reasons they list in an extensive page on WebAssembly.org. But I will try to focus on the C and C++ side here, so we'll see some WebAssembly. But it's not actually WebAssembly, because they have two formats for it. They have the actually compiled the intermediate code, and they have a human-readable text format, which looks maybe a bit like a gentle sort of Lisp language. We'll see a little bit of it, but not much. But if you do dig into WebAssembly and developing stuff, you can actually see some of the text representation inside browsers, because that's what you'll see if you do view source on the code. That's the intention of the whole system. And WebAssembly is pretty new. It was announced in 2015, and they started making demonstrations running cool stuff with it in 2016. And in March of 2017, they reached their MVP, which means that it's actually out there and works in a surprising amount of browsers. So just briefly, what's in there? What kind of data types are there in WebAssembly itself? There's 32-bit integer, C++, 64-bit integer, 32-bit floating point, and 64-bit floating point. And that's actually it. There are no strings, no strings attached. So the whole thing here is that WebAssembly is just the basics. It has a stack machine, it's an assembler, and it's up to the environments which compile to WASM to provide all the convenience, basically. You can actually write WASM by hand and run that in the browser, but you're not supposed to. You're supposed to be writing C and C++, or Rust for that matter. And also, there isn't any garbage collection yet. They want to include that, but for now it's manual memory management, which is fun. There is Freddy. Just wanted to mention it. I won't talk much about it otherwise, but not with shared state because of browsers. So you can actually run multiple threads. So what's in for a C++ developer? My first idea, and I'm thinking maybe you have other ideas as well, and feel free to jump in with questions or something at any time. I probably won't know all the answers, but maybe someone else does. We can figure it out together. That's part of the fun. So I mean, the first thing I thought about was, of course, interacting between the web world and C++ code, and of course wrapping C++ code inside a web interface, just to have something quick, cross-platform, adaptable to run your code without requiring installation or downloads and stuff like that. And of course, nobody should be left out of the fun of dealing with various browser versions and incompatibility. That's what we want. And I thought we'd just jump into a really quick I discovered this one, and I thought I didn't even expect things like this to be around. So there is a lot of fun to explore. Oh. It's incredible, the screens. Just things are where I expect them to be. So this is a fiddle for playing with WebAssembly. So on the left here is C code, basically. And on the right, it's a JavaScript environment of some kind. I couldn't really find much documentation for this, so I have questions. But the fun thing is, we create a WebAssembly module. I'll get a little bit more into this. But basically, this creates a module of the code that you can then instantiate in the browser. And then you get an instance which you can actually run and call the function on. So this is get square root from over in C land. And I wish I could see the mouse pointer. And we can run this. No, we couldn't run this. It's fine. Okay, we can build it first. And this is actually what WebAssembly looks like. Everyone loves the parentheses, right? So now we can run this and actually get a files output. It's super exciting. And I just wanted to show that this is JavaScript connection. Use the horror functions as well.
Okay, so the idea is that to create some sort of library with your C, and then you use it in your JavaScript code.
Pretty much. I wanted to show another thing here. So I got lost inside my Windows. Exactly. I just wanted to show adding another function here. So just added one that multiplies. A bit, 625. And this one's interesting, because the basic steps here are just write C++, compile to WebAssembly, look really easy, keep the build button there. Running browser, you can see there on the right side, profit. So we'll mostly be focusing on the first and third point here, writing C++ and running in the browser. Writing C++, there are things around the writing part, but I really want to, we're going to come back to that. Compiling to WASM is exciting, because this is one of those things where it gets kind of confusing to try to find out what actually the current best practice is, because there was a lot of the writing I find online about WebAssembly is from this MVP stage about a year ago, and there were lots of talking about things that would be added later, and then there's pretty much been nothing written. So maybe there's something big coming, but it's hard to know what's actually the standard. And this is one of those things, when I show the functions over there on the left, I could just hit build and run and then use them in the JavaScript. That's not actually how the documentation describes things working. The thing you need to do, you should do, is tell your compiler which functions you want to export. So the fiddle there handles a bit of magic for you, which is really nice. It's really good for starting to play. I just want to mention that there is the detail. Come back to that part as well. So who handles all the magic if you do your own development? Sure, it's just command line, just compile, right? But no, there's a lot of stuff around this. And there are several ways of compiling to WASM. But I focus on one, because this one seems to be the major one that people use, and also the one you can do the most with, as far as I found out. And that's mscripten, which I think it started as something to compile to ASM.js that I mentioned before, to compiling C++ to JavaScript. And now it provides WASM as well. And it also generates the whole page for running your code with everything around it. And it provides a lot of stuff.
Is it an editor, or is it like an IDE, or is it just a tool? Or
it's a tool. Okay. It's a pretty big tool. because it does a lot of things. It compiles to WASM, like I said, but it also provides a lot of environment for you. Large parts or majority parts of like the standard library, and it also provides, which is pretty crazy, it provides most of SDL. For graphics, and it provides a virtual file system, and it maps OpenGL to WebGL. So it does a huge amount of stuff, and it provides a lot of convenience functions, basically. Because like I said, you only have integers and floats in WebAssembly, which is a little bit limiting, and mscripten provides lots of stuff around that. And yeah, we'll get to that, we'll see some of that in examples. And also it helps with defining exports in various ways. And if you just go to mscripten's website, you'll find lots of instructions, like how to build from source. You may not want to build from source. There is something called the mscripten SDK, which is a portable, installable package. You just download, unzip, and follow the installation instructions. So I started, and I got a folder of 279 kilobytes, which felt pretty convenient and compact for something which includes Node and LLVM and some other stuff. And then you run install latest, and then you end up with a folder with 890 megabytes, which is a bit more. But it actually handles like versioning and stuff like that, so you can just install latest and you can choose which version to use. And you don't have to configure anything. You have to you have to add some variables to the path, basically. And it just works, which is pretty magical. I went through the steps a few months back to setting mscripten up in a more manual way. It worked, but it wasn't fun. So if you want to play with this locally, I really recommend mscripten SDK. And of course, I'll post all the links somewhere in the show notes, like I say in the podcast. Yeah, it works on macOS, Linux, and also on Windows.
So is it like an open source project run, or is it?
Yeah. Yes. Oh. Yeah, so you end up on GitHub as chief. And it's in the documentation, but I think it's sort of worth mentioning, because I know JavaScript and I still didn't realize this. When you're doing your examples, you end up with a compiled WebAssembly file and a web page which runs and calls the file for you, and you can write more code in it. But you need to run a small web server to serve up the file, because web browsers have lots of restrictions for making calls, and because safety, it's a good thing. But you need to run this web server. It's included really here in the docs. When I remember to look for it, it's right there. Run this, it works. But you need to, something to serve up index.html and the WASM file for things to work.
Okay, so you need to run the WebAssembly code on the server. You cannot.
No, you just need something to serve the file, because the standard way of including stuff on the web page is to make a fetch request for the file.
Okay.
So I mean, if you built the page yourself, you wouldn't have to serve it up. You could just open index.html and run it, but you might as well do the right way, because you don't really want to have to write the file yourself. And when it comes to actually running the stuff, I was surprised. It works in Chrome, I expected that. It works in Firefox, expected that one too, because Mozilla is really pushing WebAssembly. It actually works well in Safari, and actually in Edge, so it's fun. Can I use the website for checking browser support for things? Lists WebAssembly having over 72% worldwide coverage, which is really great. So you don't really need to worry about web browsers in the classic way. So how do we actually reach our code inside the browser? We've written those little functions, those that the film magically exposed for us. So we have some JavaScript API components, I guess, to fetch and use code. So we have modules, and a module is just basically just compiled code. It's just bytecode. And that needs to be turned into an instance, which actually has state and can be executed, and contains all the functions that we've chosen to expose to JavaScript. I should also say that, yes, the module is compiled and stateless, and it can be shared and cached and passed around and instantiated as many times as you like, which can be convenient. And then, because sometimes you want to pass more than just integers and floats between worlds, you also have memory, which I as a JavaScript developer found kind of mind-bending in a fun way. The memory object is just linear memory that's fully shared between JavaScript and C++ code. So when you instantiate your C++ code from WebAssembly, you pass in some memory. Use this, and then you can read and write it from both sides. So the low-level way of getting, say, a string between C++ and JavaScript is to put it in memory and then read it out on the JavaScript side. And there are some fun examples of that. And fortunately, conscripting sort of saves you from a lot of this if you use that.
So is this memory limited from to begin with? So you allocate a bunch of memory and you give it to the...
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, get to that part too. And there are also tables, which are, I think it probably makes sense if you come from the right mindset or something. I didn't. So there are sort of wrapper objects for storing function references, which sounds useful, but they don't really say what I should be using them for. But you can store references back to C++ code in them. And they're also mutable by both sides for some reason. And I haven't really seen them used in any examples. That's why I sound a bit iffy on them. And there are also, of course, exported functions, which is coming up next. And there are errors. There are a few of them, like compilers and link errors and runtime errors. And WebAssembly by itself doesn't actually catch any exceptions or exceptional conditions. So those always end up on the JavaScript side, in the browser, for you to handle. which is good to know if stuff like that starts to happen. And they also say that Stack Overflow and out-of-memory exceptions are thrown, and they say that JavaScript, just remember, it doesn't have any standard way of handling this, so you can choose what to do. It might print an error, it might crash. Okay. So this is the basic incantation for getting WebAssembly, and mscript then renders it for you. I just wanted to show it again. You get your data, turns in the buffer, you actually move forward in your slides by accident, and then you compile, you get a module which you instantiate, and there you pass in an object, often called imports, and then you get an instance back which has an exports property which contains all the C++ functions for you to call. And this imports object is actually, I won't show it right here, but it's actually mostly, it's used for providing stuff to the C++ world. In this case, it's kind of fun because it provides the web browser's console log function. So you can pass in JavaScript functions to your C++ code or your compiled code. But what is mainly used for an example is actually providing, like we said, the whole memory environment, memory configuration, various kinds. I think we'll see a long example of this in one of the examples.
What type is I here or arg?
Integer? Any type.
Okay.
Everything is any type, basically. That's one of those things that they write about, that, yeah, we want to support more clear types in the coming versions of the BNDP, and then they haven't written anything more.
But on the previous slide, I didn't get the compile step. I mean, did you compile? What did you compile there?
You compile your WASM intermediate code into something that actually runs in the browser. So the WASM, the bytecode, it's platform independent.
Okay.
So yeah, and it's kind of confusing because a few examples I've seen actually skip the compile step, and I'm not clear on what kind of magic they're doing. But this is where things go. You download the WebAssembly code and then compile it and instantiate what you've compiled. Yeah, so this one actually defines an import, which is I, which is a function that takes an argument and logs that argument to the browser's console. And just to see how it looks on the other side, Mozilla, who I stole this example from, they want to keep it simple, and simple for them was showing the handwritten WebAssembly, of course. So they didn't actually show how to do it in a useful way, but they show that it works. The function that takes imports the I and calls the I. So again, how did those C functions get there that we use in Fiddle? It depends on what you use. I mean, if you were writing WebAssembly by hand, you would define export and write it, but we don't want to do that. We're in C++, we use mscripten. And mscripten provides various ways of solving this. And the first one I already mentioned, it's the exported functions flag to just tell it the C names of the functions, not the C++ names of them. You don't want C++ manual. So it's just a command line list, and it includes the main function by default. So that's also a fun little gotcha. If you define exported functions on the command line for the first time and forget main, you suddenly had main before you said anything, and now you don't have main anymore because you forgot to add it yourself, because you overwrote the defaults. And yeah, there are some fun things around this as well, because mscripten compiles to us using LLVM. And LLVM can decide to inline stuff and remove stuff, which doesn't seem useful. So there's an inscription keep alive. I don't know what you call it, a decorator? To tell the compiler to keep this function where it is, don't inline it, because I might want to use it later. And there's also some fancy footwork stuff we'll get to. But I don't know if this is readable. But here's my function, we don't want to inline, so we put inscription keep alive before it. And they also put in extend C, because you can't use it if C++ main mangling goes into effect. And I realized a fun thing about the modules. It's, again, they're stateless, they can be passed around. So you can take your C++ code and you can pass it to a web worker, which is running JavaScript code on a background thread. You could actually have a little server running in the background on your web page, and that sort of fascinated me as a concept. So what about in the other direction, if I want to use JavaScript code in my C++ code? There are some ways, and again, this is all MScript and land. It provides lots of fun stuff for you. So there's function called mscript and run script, where you can simply pass in JavaScript as a string and run it. And they also have a macro called emasm, which they've used before for like running inline assembly code. You can use it for writing inline JavaScript code instead. And also you can actually define C APIs and then implement them in JavaScript, which is cool. So you define a C library, and then you have a library.js file where you can actually implement the stuff and call whatever JavaScript you want inside the browser. And apparently that's what MScript in itself uses for lots of stuff, like the OpenGL to WebGL mapping. So you can access the whole browser straight away. And yeah, there's one more example here. Is it even readable? This is handling web audio, and this is plain JavaScript, so it just grabs the audio context which is available in the browser, and it falls back to the web context if you don't have the audio context, and then creates one. It's a plain JavaScript, creates an oscillator, it sets a type, sets a frequency, and it plays sound. And this can actually also be done from C code with MScript, so this val global, and that accesses JavaScript. And this is the kind of magic I wouldn't want to try writing myself, but it's really nice that it works. So you can actually wrap stuff up and have C functions that call whatever JavaScript you need if you want to. I found nice walkthrough from Google, which provided a larger example with code to look at. So it's nice, and it uses a bunch of nice encryption stuff, and saving a lot of work. Like all those questions I started asking about strings, how do I get them across? And we found those low-level answers in Stack Overflow. So yes, you just create a memory, and then you just read a UTF-16 clamped array or something in JavaScript, and it works, you get ASCII out of it. MScript has nicer stuff for us. And it also shows how to wrap stuff up a bit, even if it doesn't in the same files. I think it shows sort of useful flow for code. So this is a Mandelbrot generator. Thank you. So this one is a bit more complicated. So instead of just running on the command line, they provide a makefile. It doesn't do any strange stuff. This one is a C++11. They support 14 as well. I don't think they support 17 yet, maybe parts of it. So it's what we want to compile, we want to output it. WebAssembly. And this little part here wasn't inside the tutorial, so I had to add it myself. Something has changed between the tutorial being written and today. So it couldn't find this function unless I explicitly added this little extra export to the runtime method. It's good to have Stack Overflow.
Will this work with C-break? Does anyone know?
Yeah, it should. Okay. You could just wrap it up any way you like. They just preferred make. There isn't any dependency.
Yeah, C-make generates make files. So
yeah. Perhaps. Let's see where to start. Maybe we'll start in the C++ one. So this looks pretty normal. This looks pretty normal too. And it does it imports mscript and bind, which comes in handy below. But basically what this does is generate tiles, Mandelbrot tiles. Yeah, tile size. And then all the work or the magic happens around the mixed tile function, because this one is what gets called from JavaScript to generate the next tile, simply. It's wrapped up, it's an mscript and val. And there's all the calculations, nothing unusual there. And then down here, it actually defines the return value. Which is a value, and it's an object, and it sets a bunch of data on this, and that makes all this accessible to JavaScript in a much nicer way than doing it by hand would have been. And we just return it, and down here we also define the Mandelbrot class with a constructor and the function next tile, and this also figures out exporting for us. So we take our C++ code, we wrap it up a bit in mscript to describe the parts we want to expose to JavaScript. We don't have to care about the internal functions, just the parts we want to expose. And this is also a bunch of generated setup, but we have the Mandelbrot JavaScript also about much more. But the fun part is this: on module we have the Mandelbrot class. Module is provided by Inscriptum, wrap the stuff it provides. So we have the Mandelbrot class we define. So we create an instance of that with width and height and so on. And then we have our own little draw tile function, which simply calls next tile on Mandelbrot as if it was any old JavaScript function. And this one I thought was kind of fun as well. We wrap it up because it returns image data to draw. And we wrap it up in image data from the tile data. And then we just put it on a context. And the context is just the drawing context from a canvas, which is a standard drawing area and on a web page. Works pretty much like other drawing stuff. So we can just put image data on the canvas, which is fun because when I use canvases, mostly like drawing primitives and draw lines back and forth, and no, we just did image data, we just drop it here and it works. And then this one just loops. They have a simpler version which draws the whole Mandelbrot set as once, but that's slow. This one breaks it up and wraps it up in JavaScript request animation frame, which basically I want to draw stuff smoothly when you have time, and I don't want to block the mainframe. So we can run this like any good TV chip. I'm prepared, so I'm running the Python simple HTTP server on the folder. Yay! It actually works, and it's tiled, and it's it's smooth, and we didn't have to do that much. So basically, let's see if I missed anything.
Mandelbrot.js and index HTML. No, in Mandelbrot.js you have written two. Or what was the output from this compilation step in your makefile?
Well, the output, yeah, the output in this case is.
Is that file?
Yes, it was a file. And. It was a file. And.
And this file,
or? This is, I think this is a boilerplate they threw in.
Okay.
The Mandelbrot.js is output. So that's the one. That one gets generated along with the WASM file.
But the rendering code is in WASM.
Yeah,
the high performance.
Yeah, the whole thing. Yeah. So the JavaScript just takes care of grabbing the tiles and putting them on the screen.
Yeah.
Which is
you can put stuff directly on the screen from the C++. You have to go through JavaScript to do that.
In one way or another, there's always that barrier. That's also one of the things they're talking about doing post-MVP, giving the Western world more direct access to like the whole browser environment. And again, they haven't really written anything since they wrote about that, so who knows how it's going. But for now, you probably want to handle all the actual drawing of the browser environment inside JavaScript.
But you could export those functions to this, what you talked about before, exporting the JavaScript functions to the C++. Right?
Yeah.
And then you could have the C++ doing it via the
JavaScript. Yeah, sure. Yeah. But you would have to provide the wrapper yourself, or through MScripten, of course. But it's not directly accessible as such.
It's also probably possible that using WebGL is faster. If you just want to pass pixels into a texture.
Yeah.
Probably use that instead of this method.
Yeah.
The put thing is really slow in JavaScript canvas.
Yeah, that's true. They actually wrote it in the tutorial as well, like, this is kind of overkill for doing this thing. but I just like the demonstration because the whole breaking it up and putting it into the request animation frame, it's a nice habit sort of to get into for drawing stuff on the web.
What's the size of the generated JavaScript and the WASM file?
It depends a lot on what you include from MScripten.
But in this simple example.
Let's see. Yeah, the Mandelbrot, the JS file, The JS file is 468k and the mandrake wasm is 1.6 megabytes. And this is partly my fault as well, because before I discovered the flag that I needed to add, I also turned off some optimizations just to see if that was the problem. We can actually rerun it.
But the wasm file, it's in text format. Is it possible to get it binary or? Oh. It's just pure bytes? Byte array?
No, it, the.
Because then it should be smaller, I think. Right?
Yeah.
Is that a hex viewer or is it actually written like that?
Unless Sublime is doing something behind my
back. It says plain text.
So I think it actually looks like that. But let's run this once more and see if it. Just pull it over. It's a bit smaller when you turn the optimizations back on. So yeah, 184k and for the JS and 71k for the WASM file. Which is better?
Does it still work?
Size for actually. Yeah, actually, yes. Victory.
Is it still plain text by now when you turn on the optimization?
Yeah, good question.
Is there an easy way to swap between this format and the sort of human readable Lispy format?
I would think that IDEs would provide stuff like that. I also heard that a lot of really nice debugging and viewing is coming in, like a soon to be a version of Firefox. And I don't know if any of you have used web browsers debugging tools recently, but yeah, they do a lot of good stuff. And they will include like setting breakpoints inside the WASM file and viewing the text versions and proper debugging.
So if you do like view source, do you get this or do you get like the human readable stuff?
Currently in, I realize I should have switched to like maybe the canary or something to this. But I viewed source in this and it didn't look. Oh yeah, this might be my problem.
The WASM file is fetched in the network tab as an AJAX request or something.
Yeah. I did find this before. Sources. There we are, WASM. But this isn't very exciting. So, I don't think your Chrome has gone quite as far as Firefox supposedly is right now. But yeah.
Oh, cool.
Blah, 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 blah. It's nice if you write C++, isn't it?
But you said something about threads in the beginning, because now you call the C++ call or the WebAssembly like. Like a function call from the JavaScript, right? And it returns some result to you, and then you can do something with the return data.
Yeah.
But would it be possible to have some design where you start a thread in the beginning with a WebAssembly running one thread in JavaScript and another thread, and then you set up a socket between them instead?
Yeah.
So you have like the WebAssembly running as a calculation server in the background for your JavaScript code.
Yeah, you could do that. That's the part with the web workers that I sort of realized. I mean, someone has written about it, to be sure, but it sort of struck me while I was doing the slides. Like, yeah, it would work. That would be cool. Because a web worker can take a WebAssembly module and instantiate it and run it over there, and it has APIs for posting messages back to the main JavaScript thread. So that would work. And I think that's what Emscripten does as well when it says it supports threading.
Mm-hmm.
Because I haven't read up on which types of threads it supports, but if you do write threaded stuff in C++ code in the right way, Emscripten supports it, and it, I'm pretty sure it does the web workers as well in there. Two fun examples I want to do show as well. Examples of stuff people have written using WebAssembly. So this is Unity. I think it's actually compiling the code for a person. And this is a two-player tank.
I think Unreal Engine did a 3D something with the Emscripten on.
Yep.
If I'm not mistaken.
Yep.
So what part is now running in WebAssembly? What is JavaScript here? Can you give some? I don't know how WebGL works. So is it the same concept as before? The WebAssembly is doing all the calculations and then sending like pixels or something.
Yeah. Because Emscripten provides the sort of wrapper between. The way I understand it is that they ported the Unity engine to work in WebAssembly, and then Emscripten provides the environment and then just draws to WebGL. And of course it has to handle the controls and JavaScript and stuff like that. But the loader is in progress. It's not that much in way of JavaScript as such. And then they wrapped everything up in Unity, a Unity loader object instead. But yeah, I wanted to show the outrageous version. So this is the Unreal Engine running in WebAssembly. It's fun to see it compiling for a while, but I like that. They show that part.
Is it compiling on your machine?
Yeah. Yeah, because the bytecode is platform independent, so it has to make better use of its environment.
Does the browser implement any form of cache? So if you reload it, it used the
compile? Yeah. So I was kind of afraid. Maybe I opened it before, so it will load too fast. I want to show that it takes a while. But this is the whole Unreal Engine, which is kind of outrageous. And it also, I mean, this is a pretty new MacBook Pro. I could accept that this could be okay fast, but I ran this on my 2015 12-inch MacBook at home, and it worked surprisingly well there too. So I think they actually done some measurements that they have a pretty clear performance gain when running stuff calculation heavy stuff in WebAssembly instead of JavaScript. And also sort of interesting one is that because you're downloading bytecode and parsing that instead of parsing JavaScript, you can actually get a big performance boost initially when it comes to slower computers, because it's much faster to get the WebAssembly going than to parse that huge JavaScript file of a couple of megabytes. So it, I mean, it might feel like it's another layer on top of everything else that should make stuff slower, but some stuff is actually quite a bit faster, and they still say that they have more optimizations to do to make stuff even more. To wrap up the parts, WebAssembly binary instruction format, not very interesting itself, but you have stuff like mscripten, so you can wrap your C++ code up in a nice way and expose objects and not have to write strings to memory objects. And you can have C++ in JS, and you can call JS from C++. And most importantly, play, try stuff. This is fun. Let's figure out what this is for, what it's cool for, what we can do. And of course, links will be in the show notes somewhere, posted on the meetup page, of course. So yeah, that's my part. Questions, comments, feedback?
Maybe we can discuss a bit the pros and cons of WebAssembly. So one big con is browser support, and also you can't access the browser mark, the DOM. Right?
Yeah.
And what is the cost of the bridge between them?
It's apparently varied a bit over time already. So I haven't seen any exact measurements, but he'd say that you want to keep interactions as infrequent as possible. But I mean, the Mandelbrot renderer is running at 60 frames per second, I think. And it's called a request animation frame, so it adapts a bit, but it's not a big hit in that circumstance. So I don't know. I haven't seen any exact numbers. But I think if you pass lots of data all the time, you might be in trouble.
Yeah, so that's obviously like the big cons, but then the pros, what are, I mean, it's obviously faster, as we saw with the Unreal engine, but another big pro is that you can do the streaming compilation, right?
Yeah.
Because with JavaScript, you need the entire file before you can parse it and compile it.
Yeah.
But with WebAssembly, you can start compiling as soon as you get the first byte. So soon as you have the entire file, it can possibly be compiled.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and they're pushing a lot for everything to be asynchronously handled as well. So it won't lock up while it's loading and rendering whatever setup you want to do. And of course, you get to write in other languages, which is nice.
But can you interact with, can you open sockets from the C++ code and interact with, or are you sandboxed away from that?
Depends on what
script. Can you reach out to other servers and stuff directly from the C++ code?
Yeah, we could surf around, look at docs. I think MScript provides that, because and you can wrap it into like fetch requests.
Isn't there WebSocket that JavaScript provides, which you can then use?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you'll be subject to like cross-origin rules and stuff like that, but it should work. Could go. Could be super good.
Reference.
Mm-hmm. I like cyber dwarf debugging, it sounds.
File system API?
Yeah, they have a file system API. Yeah, that's the
from the browser?
Yeah, they create some kind of virtual file system. So you preload it with the files you want to be there, and then it has it.
Can you use the local storage and then sort of save files within your own little sandbox file
system?
Yeah,
I would think that's what they do. So a script provides an inscription and script and fetch API, so you can download and stuff.
But what happens when you do printf there? How does that?
I think it wraps it up in a console log.
So that kind of guides decisions.
Yeah.
Okay, so you just do printf out of the box.
Yep.
And it will come out in your browser.
Yeah, with mscript then.
Without doing any special JavaScript code for that.
Yeah. Yeah, like they said, they've done a lot of this, you know, implementing C APIs in JavaScript. So I think I'm pretty sure that's what they do.
So you have a POSIX compliant browser.
Yeah. Yep. You know, POSIX compliance inside your browser, inside your POSIX compliant. Yeah. My head hurts.
I didn't really understand what the caveat with threading was.
You can't share state between threads.
What does that mean in this case?
If you want to do dangerous stuff with sharing memory between threads and stuff like that, you won't be allowed to.
So they cannot work with the same memory?
Yeah.
Okay.
But isn't that coming here? Possibly real native threading in the future versions? Where you can actually share memory.
Yeah, maybe. I haven't looked into it. But they've mscript and wrote something like, yeah, if the browser support this, we will too.
And I think maybe it will be coming in the future with some versions. You can actually have native threads to share memory.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised.
Not sure.
So you just promised, right? Yeah.
But what kind of communication do they have for threading?
In the browser, it's between web workers, they post messages back and forth. And it's, what is it, plain JavaScript objects, if I recall correctly. I used it a while ago, but you post messages back and forth. Yeah.
We seem very reliable on mscripting. Is there any way to do WebAssembly without it? Because I know Rust has support for WebAssembly. Do they have their own mscripting? Because we compile to LLVM and then from there we go to WebAssembly. Right?
Yeah, and there's they are writing some kind of all LLVM, a new backend, which for LLVM, and I think that's the one Rust is using as some kind of beta. But it's also one of those things that you can see. Yeah, we're working on this, and then there's no more information. But I know that Rust compiles and stuff like that, so it must have come pretty far. But a lot is dependent on mscripting, because you really want the help with the environment. That's also part of the goal, or not goal, but sort of the active decisions of WebAssembly itself, that it doesn't intend to support all this by itself, but it intends to support the formats and the basics, and then the environments are supposed to build on top of it, the abstractions you want. Same thing with memory, for example. They intend to do some more stuff with it, but not everything for everyone.
Didn't inscription start with this ASM.js subset of JavaScript? I mean, WebAssembly is just another step for them. So I mean,
they
are pre-web assembly and sort of have an environment, because I know there are SDL ports and so on for inscripting as well.
Yeah.
Which again allows you to open an OpenGL context from your compiled side.
Yeah. And it also makes it a little bit confusing to try and research out which things, if any, are the WebAssembly way. And wait a minute, am I reading about how mscripting does stuff when you compile straight to JavaScript or not? Where am I? So it's fun, but it's kind of confusing.
I guess it's just another way to deploy your code to avoid.
Yeah.
I mean, you have a JIT compiler, but now you get one step further.
Yeah.
But you still have all the whole boxing, unboxing of everything, since it's untyped out in the JavaScript world and so on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Have you seen an example running Qt? Qt?
No.
Is that would be really useful?
I think there are.
Okay.
How do you mean that you run Lebas and inside some Qt application?
You can
know the other way around.
The reverse.
I think there is on the Qt blog some example of that. I mean, they started with this, the follow-up for the solved NACL APIs on Chrome. So you can run inside. I think there are, yeah, apparently there's something.
Yeah. Because I tried it in AssembleJ, I thought it was too slow to be useful.
Live demos.
So usually it takes a couple of hours to compile Qt.
What more could you ask?
I mean, the impressive thing is that I built that at Chalmers in 98. That's when I got hooked on Qt. So that's exactly the same example. 20 years later in a browser.
No.
I couldn't do that 98.
Yeah, so Qt for WebAssembly, it's...
Can you do QML in Qt in WebAssembly?
Should be possible, right? Render is to OpenGL.
So you have a JavaScript engine wrapping something compiled running another JavaScript engine inside of it.
Oh, yeah.
Welcome to the wasteland of the real world.
Heard you like JavaScript engines.
Yes. Is Aaron supposed to do anything?
There are more pages I think we're reading at the time.
Oh, okay. Yeah, it works. Well, that's a man called Arrows, but... So what is it? You're running even in Bumble.
That's
what we're not saying.
But since you loaded and compiled the C++ modules in JavaScript, could you sort of stage that? You load something minimal? I guess they do that to show that transition, but I mean you want to avoid a web page that takes 10 seconds to show more than the logo.
Everyone has left it already.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it could be that the spinning thing is that. It's just that it looks bad.
Yeah,
but then
I thought I'd seen stuff like start immediately when you reloaded it, but apparently not today.
But yeah, it should be possible. I mean, if nothing else, you could just save it locally and should be able to bring it up right where you left off. Who doesn't like a green spinner, right?
Yeah. Reminds me of the Atari ST.
It's on this kind of sounds as well.
Is that smart? There's no bombs.
Yeah.
Right. Anything else?
Talking about support on mobile phone browsers?
I know, I'm pretty sure Safari works. I think Chrome would work too. Otherwise, I don't think they would have got those support numbers. Chrome for Android, version 64. Not Opera Mini, surprise. iOS Safari works too, yeah. So not too bad. Okay, yeah.
Thank you.